In this video, we introduce dielectrics, or insulators, and we talk about their behavior between the plates of a capacitor. So first, let's see what happens qualitatively if we charge up a capacitor, disconnect it from the power source, that's the first picture here, and then insert a dielectric substance between the plates, that's the second picture here. Now, charges are not really free to move around in this dielectric. That's sort of the definition of an insulator. But you can stretch the electron clouds around the molecules a little bit. And I have a downward electric field between these two plates. That means there's an upward force on the electrons around all of the molecules in the insulator. And so I can stretch the electron clouds upward, and I end up with a picture like this. Now, inside the dielectric material, everything is still neutral because every negative on these little electric dipoles is right next to a positive on the one above it. But something significant happens at the surface of the insulating material. I can see I have a bunch of electron clouds stretching upward right to that upper surface of the dielectric. And that means there's a small negative charge on that surface. Likewise, at the bottom surface of the dielectric, I've stretched my electron clouds a little bit upward, leaving a slight positive charge on the bottom surface of the dielectric. The net result of this polarization is that the dielectric itself now looks like a parallel plate capacitor with a positive plate on the bottom and a negative plate on the top. So I end up with a small induced electric field pointing upward. So this small induced electric field partially cancels the original electric field, and that's where we begin getting into the mathematics here. I'm going to say that my new electric field is equal to the original divided by some constant, and traditionally we use a kappa for that. And that kappa is called the dielectric constant. That's just a property of a material, and every different type of material has a different kappa. Well, if the electric field between the plates has been reduced, then I know the potential between the plates has been reduced as well. So what I'm appealing to here is the fact that the electric field between the plates of a capacitor is given by potential difference over the gap between the plates. And I can say the original potential difference is related to the original electric field by V0 equals E0 times D. What about my new potential? It's going to be the new electric field times D, but that's E0 over kappa times D. And I recognize the E0 D in the numerator, and I see that my potential is the original potential over kappa. So the potential difference across the plates has also been reduced as a result of the reduced electric field between the plates. Now let's examine what happens to the capacitance. The original capacitance was the charge on the plates over the potential difference between them. Notice I didn't put a subscript on the Q because the Q isn't changing. And that's key to all these derivations on this particular video. I've disconnected the capacitor from the power source, so there's no way I can have any more charge transfers. Q is fixed. So how about our new capacitance? That's Q over our new potential difference. But our new potential difference was V0 over kappa. So when I divide by V0 over kappa, that's the same as multiplying by kappa. And I end up with a factor of kappa out in front of Q over V0, which is the original capacitance. So I see that my capacitance is increased by a factor of the dielectric constant. Now that formula is particularly important because it will apply whether or not we're dealing with a capacitor that's been disconnected from the power source or if it's still connected to the power source. You can always say that if you put the dielectric in there, the capacitance goes up by a factor of the dielectric constant. For example, if you were given the dimensions of a capacitor and the dielectric constant between the plates, you could compute the capacitance based on the geometry of the capacitor. And our old formula was ε0A/d. And now to generalize, I'm just going to put a kappa in there for the dielectric constant of the material between the plates. We'll get to one of those examples in another video. For now, looking at a quick example of comparing a parallel plate capacitor with no dielectric to what happens if you put in a dielectric with constant 2.0 in between the plates. And we're primarily concerned with energy in this example. So I have an original capacitance of 1 microfarad. I charge to 5 volts potential difference, and I disconnect it from the power source. A, compute the energy in the capacitor before the dielectric is inserted. You can use 1/2 CV² for this, and C is going to be 1 microfarad, that's 10^-6 farads, and V is 5 volts. And when I run the numbers on this, I get 1.25 times 10 to the negative 5th joules. In B, I'm asked for the new capacitance after the dielectric is inserted. Well, I know the new capacitance is just going to be kappa times the original capacitance. That's twice the original capacitance, which was 1 microfarad. So now it's 2 microfarads. In part C, I'm asked to find the energy in the capacitor after the dielectric has been inserted. So if I write down the formula, 1/2 CV squared. I know that my new capacitance is given by kappa times the original. That's 2 microfarads. But V has changed. You have to be really careful about that. Provided I'm not connected to the power source anymore, V is going to drop by a factor of kappa. We derived a little formula for that when the dielectric is inserted. So I end up with 1/2 kappa C naught times V naught over kappa all squared. One factor of kappa is going to cancel, and I end up with a 1 over kappa out in front times 1/2 C naught V naught squared. In other words, the potential energy goes down by a factor of kappa. Just one more formula for the list. Okay, so all I have to do then is insert kappa equals 2, and I see that I get 1/2 the original potential energy. I guess I could call that PE naught. I'll change it in part A. And that comes out to 0.625 times 10 to the negative 5th joules. I just wanted to keep the power of 10 constant there because it makes comparison easier. Now keep in mind that everything changes if this thing is connected to a power source, because that power source is going to maintain the potential difference at a constant value. The way it's going to do that is by pumping more charge onto the plates when you add the dielectric. And I'll post a link to a video where I do that calculation. If you find the physics content on Zach's Lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce over 100 new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.